Right. Good morning, evening, afternoon, everybody. Thanks so much for joining for our From the Field webinar today. Big thank you to our From the Field sponsors today, Kathy and Tom Lydon. Kathy and Tom Lydon also support my work here in the Western Cape, so we really appreciate their continued support of our work here. If you are interested in sponsoring one of our future webinars, please get in contact with Kate Fitzwilliams, and you'll see her contact details there. I'll post them again at the end of the webinar if you would like to take them down. All right, so let's get started. My name is Christie Craig, and I am a PhD candidate and field officer based down in the Western Cape, based in Cape Town in South Africa. I'm based with our partner NGO here in South Africa, the Endangered Wildlife Trust. And I'm busy with a PhD on the blue crane. So today I'm going to be telling you a little bit about the work that we're doing with blue cranes, sharing some of the results that we have so far and some of the plans that we have going forward. So this is the blue crane. It's South Africa's national bird. They're really beautiful, graceful birds. They stand at just over a meter high. And just a little bit about the blue crane family tree. So this diagram here, what you're looking at is a phylogenetic tree of all of the crane species in the world. And in the middle here, we have the blue crane, which is most closely related to the demoiselle crane on the bottom. And they are found in Northern Africa and parts of Asia. And then less closely related, they are to the wattled crane. And actually in parts of South Africa, blue crane and wattled crane occur together. And it has once or twice been recorded that blue crane and wattled crane interbred. So looking at the family tree, you can see how that may be possible. So blue crane is what we call a near endemic. We find them mostly in South Africa. There's a very small population up in Namibia around the Atosh. This population has been declining quite steadily. And for a number of years now, they haven't counted more than 50 cranes in this area. So a very, very small proportion of the population is found in Namibia. But the vast majority is found within South Africa. So one of the places in South Africa, we talk about three different subpopulations. And one of the blue crane subpopulations is in the eastern grasslands, where Bradley is based. And in the past, this used to be the stronghold for the blue crane. This used to be where most blue cranes were found. But in the 1970s and 1980s, this population declined quite dramatically. Some estimates are up to 90% decline. And this was due to degradation of the grasslands, afforestation, so the development of forestry, degradation of wetlands, as well as poisoning. And today, a small proportion of our blue cranes are now found in the grasslands, so we estimated about 14%. And then we have another, probably the biggest natural population we find in the Karoo, which is the central arid part of the country. It's typically a small stock farming area, quite dry, very low human population density. And this population's been pretty stable. There were some declines in the 1970s and 80s, but generally this population's been quite stable and healthy. And then the Western Cape. So we estimate now that over half of all blue cranes in the world are found within the Western Cape, which is quite interesting because they didn't used to occur in the Western Cape. What you're looking at here in this picture is what the natural vegetation looks like in many parts of the Western Cape. The vegetation is something called fynbos or rhinosterfelt. It's quite tall, shrubby type vegetation, not very well suited for cranes. But blue cranes started to move into the Western Cape as people started clearing this vegetation for agriculture. And as more and more land was cleared, the crane population started to increase, and they did very well in this agricultural landscape. But there are some concerns with blue cranes being in this very artificial, intensively farmed landscape. which is one of the reasons that we are busy with work in the Western Cape. So just to orientate those of you not from South Africa, the Western Cape is this province down in the southwest of the country. And this is typically what these agricultural landscapes look like. The Western Cape area is dryland cropping, so it's been quite extensively transformed. Some of these landscapes are pretty much devoid of any natural vegetation. So these landscapes are typically a mosaic of cropping areas such as wheat, canola, oats, barley, and interspersed by these planted pastures such as Medix and Lucerne and Lupin, which is typically used for small stock. And this is what this landscape looks like during winter at the moment. Very green, very lush. It's the peak of the growing period for the wheat. And during this time, the crops get quite tall, which isn't very suitable for the cranes. So you'll typically find blue cranes during the peak of winter in these planted pasture areas. And then if you look into the summer, after the wheat and canola and other crops have been harvested, the blue cranes will start moving into these stubble fields. And the summer is when blue cranes breed, so they often breed in these stubble fields. And typically during the summer, there's a lot more habitat available for them because these crop fields open up and they still have the pasture lands available to them. So blue crane are listed as vulnerable on the IUCN Red List. Those of you not familiar with the Red List, it's basically a way of categorizing species according to their extinction risk. And the categories range from extinct through to least concern. And blue cranes are listed as vulnerable, which is one of the threatened categories. And this was because of those massive declines that I spoke about in the grassland areas. So the focus of my work, I'm busy with a 4-year PhD, I'm currently halfway. And the focus is to look at this Western Cape population, which is basically an artificial population. It's a population that's quite very reliant on agriculture. And it's just to kind of understand the state of the population and to understand how viable it is in the long term. So my project is based at the Fitzpatrick Institute of African Ornithology, which is at the University of Cape Town. And there I am supervised by Professor Peter Ryan. And then I'm co-supervised by Tanya Smith, who is my manager at Endangered Wildlife Trust. And as I mentioned, Tom and Kathy Lydon support this project. So basically, the first question that we have is, what is the state of the population? How are the cranes breeding? How many cranes are there? And what has been the population trend? And we also want to have a look at what the current threats are, what is the extent, what impact is it having on the population? And then bring this information together and look at some future scenarios. What might the future look like for this agriculturally dependent population? So this is some work that I did during our lockdown period this year. So what you're looking at is some data from one of South Africa's citizen science projects. So this is data from the South African Bird Atlasing Project. And I was working on a technique that Sally Hoffmeyer used from 2012. She did her PhD looking at some of this citizen science project. And basically what I did is I updated this map to include some of the more recent data. So how it works is each of these block cells is something called a quarter degree grid cell. And anybody who's interested in birds can go into this area and record all the bird species that they see for a certain amount of time. And then as more and more people submit data, we can get an idea of reporting rates. So how often do people report, for example, blue crane in one of these cells? And that can give us an idea of abundance or the number or how common a species is in that area. So what this map is showing you is a comparison between the two separate projects. So the first one ran from 1987 until 1991. And then the second project ran from 2007 and is ongoing. So what this algorithm does is it compares the reporting rate between suburb one and suburb two. So if a cell is red or orange, that indicates that there's been a significant decline in reporting rate, which indicates to us that the species has become less common or less abundant in that area. So that's very much what we're seeing in the eastern grasslands, where I explained about the massive declines that we've seen in that area. And whereas a light green or yellow indicates that there's not been a significant trend, which is pretty much what we're seeing in the middle of the country in the Karoo. And then a blue, dark blue or dark green cell indicates that there's been a significant increase in reporting rate, which is what we're seeing in the Western Cape. So this is just a really nice visual representation of what we're seeing in the population as a whole. So this map gives you an idea of the extent of transformation for agriculture in the Western Cape. You can see that parts of the southern and western areas are very transformed. That purple color indicates all the land that's been transformed for agriculture, which is not a great thing for the natural vegetation, but for cranes it's been positive because it means that a lot of habitat opened up for them. So we refer to these two areas as the Overberg and the Swartland. And in terms of crane numbers, we find the vast majority of blue cranes within these agricultural landscapes. And we typically find that in the Overberg, blue crane numbers are typically 3.5 times denser in the Overberg than in the Swartland. So most of our blue cranes in South Africa are found within this Overberg region. And how we got some of this data was through doing aerial surveys. So a big thank you to the Bataliers who have helped us with 4 flights so far. And a big thank you to Mark Rule who flew us for those flights. So we did a winter flight in September 2018. So what we did was, what you're looking at here is our flight paths in that black line. And the blue dots indicate every blue crane sighting that we saw. And during winter, blue cranes flock in quite large numbers, sometimes more than 100. So you can see we're seeing quite a lot of bigger flocks during the winter time. And you'll remember that I said that during the winter, they often are constrained to these pasture and fallow areas that are more suitable during that time of year when the crops are very tall. So this green color indicates all the habitat that is available to them during that time. And then if we have a look at the next survey that we did during summer, you can see if I flick back to the previous slide, you can see that the habitat in brown here, the available land that's available to them opens up a bit more because their crops have been harvested, which means they can access those areas as well. So we followed the same flight paths, and you can see that we're seeing a lot more pairs and smaller flocks. That's because during the summer, blue cranes are breeding. So most breeding birds will have paired up and they start defending a territory. We did see a couple of flocks, and that's because birds that aren't breeding or haven't started breeding yet will remain in the flocks during the summer. So some other citizen science data that we have available to us is from the coordinated avifaunal road counts. This is also a citizen science project. And how it works is all of these dotted lines here that you're seeing are routes around the country that were set up. Anybody who's interested can go out and drive this route It happens on a set day twice a year, once in winter, once in summer. And there's a standard protocol where you record birds every 2 kilometers or when you see them. So you can see there's a nice density of roots in the Overberg and the Swartland area. And this project's been running since 1993, which gives us a really nice long-term data set to look at for blue crane. So what I did was I had a look at some of these counts from these surveys. So what you're looking at here on this graph is the total blue cranes counted per 100 kilometers surveyed since 1993 in the Overberg. And you can see up until about 2011, the population was increasing quite substantially. But since 2011, there's been, the trend has turned around a bit, and it seems like it's declining at a slower rate, which is quite concerning given that quite a large proportion of our blue cranes in South Africa are found within the Overberg. So in the Swartland, similarly, we were seeing an increase up until about 2007. And then since then, it's kind of leveled off and seems to be in a bit of an equilibrium. Another way that we are assessing the state of the population is by monitoring blue crane breeding. So from about September, I'll start to monitor blue crane breeding pairs. They'll start to defend territories and pair up. And then I monitor them on a roughly monthly basis to look at how they're progressing. From when they lay eggs, they typically lay a clutch of about 2 eggs, through to when the hatchlings come and then as the chicks grow. And then I make notes of when a chick fails and when the pair start to breed again. So this gives us an indication of what the breeding success is and how many new cranes are coming into the population each year. So onto some of the threats. The main threat that blue cranes face is through power line collisions. They are quite prone to colliding with power lines, just in the way that their eyesight is. They don't have very good vision in front of them. And they're also quite a big bird, so that it can't maneuver very easily. And a fair number of blue cranes do collide with power lines each year. So something that we are interested in doing with our research, and this particular part of the project is supported by our power utility in South Africa, Eskom. So something that they did for the little bustard in Portugal, which is also a species that is quite adapted to agriculture and also has is fairly prone to colliding with power lines, is they built something called a collision risk index. And how they did with this was they made observations of how little bustards were flying. They also put satellite trackers on them to look at how often they were flying, at what height they were flying, and in what direction. So it really allowed them to track how they were flying. And they also got an indication of habitat suitability. So what habitats were these little bustards using? And using these bits of information, they managed to get something called the collision risk index for the country, indicating areas where the flight or the type of habitat would probably indicate that they may be at higher risk of colliding with a power line in that area. They then overlaid this with the power lines that are existing in the country to basically say, okay, these are the power lines that are probably going to be more problematic for little bustards. And this is something that we're really keen to do for blue crane and the Western Cape. And the reason for this is because we would like to identify power lines that are likely to be problematic to blue cranes, because Eskom is committed to making power lines safer for birds. And one of the ways they can do this is to put these flappers or markers on the lines. They make them a lot more visible to blue cranes, and they're particularly effective for blue cranes in reducing collision risk. So if we can identify certain power lines that would be a priority for these kind of markers, then Eskom can prioritize those for proactive mitigation. So the first data we need is some data on how blue cranes are moving. So this is something that we're going to be using satellite tracking technology to do. So actually at the end of this month, we're going to go out and catch some blue cranes. We set up some foot noose traps at areas that they congregate. And then once we've got the crane in hand, we put some color rings on them and a satellite tracking device, which takes location and the flight height and sends this through remotely through the cell phone network. So we can get an idea of how blue cranes are moving. This is just an example of the kind of data that we expect to get from this. This is some of the early data we got from one of the juveniles that had one of these trackers. So using that data, we would come up with a collision risk index, much the same as they did for the little bustard. And because we know that they use agricultural landscapes, we've got a good indication of what habitats they're using. We've got good mapping data on what crops are planted where. So using this, we can come up with a model to say, okay, these are areas where there's likely to be more blue crane collisions. But a model is not very useful if it doesn't predict accurately. So what we want to do is ground truth these models. And the way that we're doing this is through doing power line surveys. So what we do is, this is an example of some of the power line surveys we're doing in the Swatland. You can see the power line network here, and these blue lines indicating our surveys that we've done last summer. So in total, we're planning to do a total of 384 kilometers or 237 miles in the Western Cape. And a big thank you to the Namibia's special management area who's been helping us with some of the power line surveys in the Overberg. So basically what we do is we walk underneath the power lines and we record any species that we found, including blue cranes. And this data will allow us to try and ground truth these models that we're developing. So some of the other threats to cranes, definitely is challenging for blue cranes to be living in these very intensively farmed agricultural landscapes. One of the challenges is there's quite a high density of fences. And blue cranes, particularly juvenile blue cranes that can't fly yet, do get caught in fences from time to time. One of the other issues that comes up occasionally is that blue cranes can congregate in quite large numbers around sheep troughs, and for some landowners that's a bit of a nuisance. Similarly, they can cause damage to certain crops, particularly sweet lupin. And not all landowners find this a problem, but some do. So there is a bit of a potential for conflict between cranes and farmers. And we do have some concerns about climate change. The Western Cape is predicted to get hotter and drier with climate change. And this is a trend that we are seeing already in some parts. So it's difficult to know how this may affect the landscape. Might end up looking a little different if people start switching to different types of agriculture. So we're not sure how this would affect cranes in the long term. So one of the ways that we are using to try and get answers to some of these questions is doing interviews with farmers. So last year, Bradley and I went and interviewed 22 Overberg and Swartland farmers. And we did quite in-depth interviews set for typically about half an hour to an hour with the farmers, chatting about their practices on the farms and some of their challenges. We asked them questions about their attitudes and their experiences with blue cranes. And then we also gleaned from their knowledge about some of the threats to cranes. So, for example, the issue of fences. Farmers spend a lot of time maintaining their fences, and they're definitely going to know if they've come across a blue crane in their fence. So what we did is we asked the farmers to recall how many blue cranes they had found on their fences in the last 2 years to kind of give us an indication of how many cranes are being affected by this. So in the Overberg, 7 of the 11 farmers said that they had found a crane on their fence in the last 2 years, and the number on average was 2.5 cranes in the space of 2 years. In the Swartland, this only 3 of the farmers said that they'd found cranes on their fences. And because blue crane densities are a bit lower in the Swartland, this does make sense. And on average, they said they were finding one crane in a space of 2 years. So on the issue of climate change, there was, in the Western Cape, there was a drought quite recently, a quite severe drought. And because we expect the Western Cape to get hotter and drier with climate change, we kind of use this as a case study to discuss future adaptation to climate change with the farmers. So we said to them, if the trend is to continue to be hotter and drier, how might you change your practices? So at the moment, we seem to be getting quite mixed responses to this question. So we'd like to do a bit more interviews, which we had actually planned to do this year. Unfortunately, with the COVID situation, it's not really safe to go and meet farmers in person. Obviously, we do have the option of doing these interviews over the phone or over Zoom, but I think there's some real advantages in meeting farmers in person. I think you get a lot of information, you build a better rapport. So for example, this picture shows one of the farmers who actually took us around the farm to show us some of the things that we were talking about. And here he's showing us some of the damage that they get from rodents on the farm and showing us how they control them. So I think there's some real benefits to in-person interviews. So we're going to wait until it's a bit safer so we can go meet farmers in person again. So ultimately, the main question of my project is to understand whether the Western Cape population is viable in the long term. And using all this data that we're collecting, we're going to look at crane biology, mortality and habitat, and look at some future scenarios, looking at if different things change, what might the population look like in 100 years' time. So this exercise will help us pinpoint some key areas of concern for the blue crane and also some opportunities for conservation. And one of the main outputs for my thesis will be developing a conservation plan through the conservation or open standard, which is a process that many conservation NGOs follow, including ourselves, to develop our conservation projects. And for me, this is one of the most exciting parts about the project is putting this research into practice. So that's in a nutshell, my work, and I hope you found it interesting. Please let us know if you have some questions, and we will do our best to get to them.
There's a couple of questions here. Please send some more questions as we talk and go along with it. The question here by Jane Mayers, is there any legal gun hunting? And I must say, it's a bit of a question to answer because and I could also share experience, Christie, as well with that, because I know from experience, there's a number of other forms of hunting happening all the time, but it's not, people go out hunting. There are some bird shoots for game birds, various other species, and of course the game hunting. Illegal, it obviously happens, but not too much of a large scale. We have other hunting purposes, people hunting with dogs, that can be a big problem, especially in different regions of the country as well. But yeah, Christie, want to add to anything about that with illegal gun hunting?
Yeah, so as you say, there's definitely hunting of other bird species. So like geese species, particularly early in the growing season, cause a lot of damage on crops. So there's definitely hunting of those species, which is perfectly legal. It would be obviously illegal to hunt a blue crane because they are protected. I've never heard of any hunting happening with blue crane. I don't know if you have, Bradley.
No, not really. Not for gun hunting, but obviously with the normal hunting with the dogs is the biggest threat because often the dogs just catch whatever they can find. And most of those are illegal in that case. Yeah. Just the next question here is, are there natural predators for these cranes? And I mean, I'll answer that, yes. I mean, we have jackals that can take out a crane chick. And in some cases, some of your birds of prey can even go for the small chicks, the very small ones that have just hatched. That can happen as well. So nice question, because it's also, it's not large scale. It happens in minor cases, but in some cases you do also realize that there were two chicks the one day and then there's one missing and you can't find any evidence. So yeah, there are natural predators. Now, what do blue cranes eat? And Christie, you'll add to this as well, but I know they will eat mainly insects in most cases, and they will take up some seed grains. I mean, the karoos are one of the example of places that you see them eating when they're feeding on natural areas. It's most of the time in the wintertime, especially when there are not many insects, they'll go for these little bulbs, small little bulb species, but they're eating the karoo. And then, yeah, different parts of the Western Cape, they'll obviously go for different things. And yeah, I'd like you to add some more there, Christie, on that.
Yeah, so they'll definitely eat the fallen grains after they have harvested, which is probably one of the reasons that you find blue crane in these stubble fields, is because there's a lot of grain that falls. They do feed around sheep troughs in the Western Cape. So during this time of year, you often find several hundred around a sheep trough eating the grain and the sheep feed that they put out. But yeah, mainly insects, grass seeds, that kind of thing.
And Henry, thanks for your question. Have there been other studies of blue cranes using remote transmitters? Do you plan to deploy them on juveniles or adults? And what additional information will you learn from those transmitters?
Yeah, so there was another study done by an MSc student by the name of Sydney Davis, and they put 11 trackers on cranes in the Overberg, and they used that to look at home range. So I'm actually going to use some of that same data to look at it from the angle of the collision risk. So we're kind of adding to that data. So we're fixing on adults this time. We did fit some on juveniles last year. Unfortunately, we've had mixed success with those trackers. So the ones that we are fitting now are actually based on the Iridian satellite network. So they don't actually need cell phone network. So they're going to be a lot more reliable. And in terms of what else we can look at, there's so many things you can do with this kind of data. We can look at habitat utilization, how they're using the habitats, what distances they're moving, what are their home ranges. There's so many different questions. It's a really nice data to have.
And Robin Phillips, thanks for your question. Are blue cranes avoiding the wind turbines? So far, South Africa's got a couple of studies going on with areas with blue cranes. And at the moment, they've come up in parts where there are blue cranes populations. And so far, we have known of a few that have collided. I know my last figures I had was 3 that have collided with wind turbines. So at the moment, it's very early to tell because we're still quite new into wind farms in the country. So it's also very early information. So I don't want to get too excited, but compared to other threats, it's also, we can only really look at those, correlate that in the future when we've got more information. So the question, yes and no. So unfortunately, we do have incidents, but you know, it's still early stages to see how bad it could be if it does get bad in the future. And Tom, thank you so much for your question, and thanks so much for your support. Tom Lydon, how close do cranes, I suppose, get to each other?
Sorry,
Tom, I don't mind, if you mind, just give me the question again. It says, how close do cranes next to each other? Does that mean stay with each other?
So if we're thinking of breeding pairs, so like territories, I guess that's what we're looking at. So yeah, in the Overberg, you can find breeding pairs really close to each other, as in like, in one field you have a breeding pair, in another field you have another breeding pair, which is quite amazing, really. So I think during the breeding season, territories can be quite small.
And Robert, your question, can wires be made more visible using colors, ribbons, or even sound emitters? And that's obviously the wires for the fences, I assume, or wires for power lines. We'll answer the question for both. I'll start off with the wires for fences. I have actually tried to experiment myself by putting on different tubes of different colors, and it's difficult to tell if it worked because, I mean, it worked, but I mean, I don't even know, because the birds get entangled in fences that are in different areas, it's hard to tell if that, if we have, you know, a way that they, if it worked in that situation, but I don't know if it was like a crane highway to get through different fences. And for power lines, we have tested different types of colors on the power lines. Most common, it's a yellow color, where it makes more visible for the power lines, for the birds to see it flapping in the wind. So definitely is a thing. We're going to be testing more devices in different parts of the country with power lines to see if they work as well. And Gene, your question, is there control practice by farmers that involves poisoning? So yeah, I must say poisoning is a bit of an issue. We do have poison cases that do happen. And most of our poisons that are used in agricultural things are safe for cranes. We have to, poisons have to go through different trials before poisons can be used. And so if you do find poisoning of cranes, it is done 100% of the time, basically intentional, but not really for cranes. It could be intentional for other species of birds. And then cranes could suffer from that, because the actual agricultural poisons should not, in that case, should not poison the cranes.
Yeah, and so then, I think in the cases that there have been crane poisonings, it's often because poisons have been put out for other damage-causing birds like geese, and cranes just happen to come across that bait and eat it. But either way, it's not legal to poison birds in South Africa.
Okay, Christie, a question for you there. How big is nest predation?
Nest predation. So we don't really know. We're actually wanting to do a bit more research on kind of the really detailed information on what actually happens to some of these nests. So at the moment, when I'm monitoring these nests, I'm monitoring on roughly a monthly basis. So if I come on the next couple of weeks and I find that a crane no longer has it, we don't really know why. So what we're actually looking at is potentially getting some more research to put up some camera traps at these nest sites to try and understand what are the reasons that these chicks are being lost. Is it predation, or are they just not doing well and dying? So that's something that we are interested in finding more information on, because it's quite important to know.
To get back to Tom's question, yeah, thanks for bringing the question back again. So it says, how close do they nest next to each other? So basically, you know, how big are their territories? And based on this, what is the potential population size? Christian, I'd like to answer from your side, because of the Overberg population and Swartland population in Western Cape. It would be nice to give an answer from your side.
So because I've definitely seen them nesting pretty close to each other, within probably a couple hundred meters, if that. So theoretically, in terms of breeding density, there's probably a lot of scope for the population to be denser than it is. But as I mentioned, during the winter, the available habitat becomes a bit smaller. So I guess it would depend on kind of the habitat that's available during the winter, what kind of densities might we see cranes during that time versus the breeding season density.
Yeah, Nettle Smith, I like your question here. Are cranes good swimmers? And then also, mom and dad have long legs, but in the photo looks like the youngster looks very aquatic. That's really nice, because I must say, I've also seen cranes hatch and then straight away can swim. It's actually amazing to see that. Mm-hmm. So yeah, cranes are good swimmers, and it's really a cute thing to see. But often it will be the ones that are nesting on islands on a dam or something. So I like mm-hmm. it's a nice experience to talk about, because they really are cute when they little fluff balls busy swimming on a dam. And then Wendy Brown, your question, are there other species for which that the collision risk model has been developed? And if so, has it been useful? So that's obviously with the power line collision risk model.
So I definitely know the one for the little bustard. One of our colleagues at EWT has just done one for lesser flamingo, which has definitely been useful for them. I think that the paper is still in process, as far as I know. So yeah, that research will be out soon. They used a similar approach to what we're doing, is using satellite trackers to look at collision risk. Yeah, those are the ones that I can think of offhand.
Our next question, are there wattle cranes in the Western Cape as well? That's an easy question. The answer is no. There have been stories that there was a wattle crane in the past, so many thousands of years ago. But no, at the moment, the best place to see wattle cranes is the eastern part of South Africa, so in the grassland region where I'm working, but majority in the province called KwaZulu-Natal, which is the east coast of South Africa. So very good place to see them in that part. And Elaine, your question, are blue cranes migratory? The answer for that would probably be safe to say that they local migrants. So what happens, because of their breeding sites being in a certain area, they'll then move in a group in the wintertime around different parts. So very close by to where their breeding sites are, but in large groups they'll move around. So they don't migrate like sandhill cranes can move from the north side of America right down to the south. Not as like that at all, but just local migrants in different areas. Okay, Fiona, thanks for your question. What is the breeding season of the blue cranes? And Christy, you can describe when it starts in the Overberg.
So from about, I think it differs slightly in your area, Bradley, and in the Karoo, but they generally start a bit earlier in the Western Cape. So from about September, they'll start pairing up and you'll see them dancing together, starting to defend a territory. And then depending on whether they're nesting in the pastures, so in the pastures, they can start a bit earlier because that have tufts available. If they are wanting to nest in the crop fields, then they've got to wait until those are harvested, which is about October, November. So we generally see the peak of the breeding season being in about November. And then most cranes will start fledging from about March onwards, sometimes a bit earlier if they started earlier. But there's obviously a bit of variation. There's a very strange pair out in the Stellenbosch area of the Western Cape that breed often in July, August. So there's a bit of variation.
Yeah, thanks, Christy. It's a lot different in different parts of the country because they have their own ways of doing it. The next question, what is the incubation period of the blue cranes? So it's basically 30 days a month for the eggs to hatch. And then do blue cranes roost in trees like the grey crown cranes? Unfortunately, they're not adapted for that. Their feet just won't allow it, the way that their feet are working. So they can't roost on trees. They're more on the ground for that reason. And then do the blue crane lay eggs in wetlands only or in grasslands too? So a nice question, because you can see in the Western Cape, they are basically nesting on those canola stroke wheatlands in the summertime. But in the grasslands, you can find them majority on an open grassland itself, making a nest. And the odd one, when I say the odd, very few of them will actually make a nest in a wetland or in a dam. So it is likely, but very, very low chance. So probably like 19 out of 20 birds will be in a flat grassland. And then the same will be for the Western Cape and Karoo, that majority of them will be in that habitat that they've adapted to nesting in. Yeah, the next question, farmers in Swartland plant a bit of sweet lupins. Can a study survey be done going forward as from car counts? A lot of the cranes are found on this crop, especially in winter on Swartland roots. So that's from Brian van der Walt. Thanks for your question.
So that's definitely something we can look at with the car data. So with those car counts, people report their habitat as well. So I know that Sally looked at habitat selection with her study. So yeah, that's definitely something that could be done with the car data.
And Betty, thanks for your question. Can you say more about the drought conditions? We heard a great deal about Cape Town's water supply, but little follow-up. Is this a progressive situation? That's especially for you, Christy.
It was particularly bad in 2018. So we had all the talk of day zero, and obviously that had massive impacts on the farming community as well. The rainfall since, I think 2019 might have also been a drier year. Obviously it depends, certain areas might have good rainfall, certain areas don't. From what I can tell from what farmers are saying this year, the rainfall's been a lot better. So hopefully we're now coming out of this drought period and allow the farming community a little bit of relief.
Next question, based on interviews conducted with the farmers, what was the extent of negative perception towards the cranes?
So definitely mostly positive. Bradley also be able to comment, we did these interviews together, that farmers generally in these areas are quite positive towards cranes. I mean, some of them, you ask kind of about crane numbers and they say, well, if they stay at the number that they are at the moment, as long as they don't get more. So I think for the most part, as long as cranes aren't causing any damage or any issues, many farmers are very tolerant towards cranes. A lot of them also really love having the cranes on their farm and are very proud to have cranes on their farm. So generally positive, very lucky to have landowners in Western Cape that are keen to have cranes on their farm.
I'm going to put the two questions together. These are two questions from Linda and from Kelly as well. Do they typically have two chicks? And if so, do both chicks usually survive? How long do they stay with their parents? And then Kelly's question, how long from laying do chicks hatch? And if two hatch, do they hatch at the same time? So that's a nice story, because that's basically how the crane starts as chicks.
Yes, I think Bradley already said they incubate for 30 days. As far as I know, they generally hatch one day apart if there's two eggs. Correct me if I'm wrong, Bradley. And then, yeah, it'll depend on the year, but in the Western Cape, you often see two chicks being raised. I'll need to have a look at my data to remember what the proportion is, but I think generally one, sometimes two. This last year, we came across one where there were three chicks raised, which is very unusual. So yeah, generally one, sometimes two. And then they will stay with their parents at least until about March, April. And when they can fly, they may move off to a flock. But often when I'm watching flocks in the winter, you can see that there's kind of little family groups. So the juveniles are still sticking around with their parents throughout the winter. So I think it varies, but I've definitely seen families sticking together in the winter as well.
This is a nice one for you, because this is also early stages to say this, but over the long term, is climate change likely to impact on the distribution of blue cranes across their range? So Christie will give a much better answer on this one.
It's tricky to say. I think in terms of the distribution, I'm not sure whether it will change, at least on the Western Cape. I think definitely in the Western Cape, it would depend on what the impact of climate change is on agriculture, because that may then have a knock-on effect on the cranes. Something else to consider is the temperature tolerance of cranes. So this is something I often think about when I go out during the summer breeding season, which is also the dry season. These cranes sitting incubating in these bare fields, and it's hot and there's a heat haze. So if the air is going to become hotter, I guess the question is, are blue cranes going to be tolerant to hotter temperatures? Are they going to be able to breed successfully if it becomes hotter?
Great. Just a question here. I'm going to combine the two questions. The one question is there any threat to blue cranes from poaching, as well as about crane domestication?
I think in the past, domestication used to be a lot more of a thing. I often hear kind of older farmers talking about how they had a pet crane back in the day. Because it used to be legal, I think. Nowadays, you're not allowed to keep cranes as pets. I think it probably does happen every now and again. I know that there were two cranes that were poached, never found on a train, and then rehabbed and released. I think it does happen every now and again. I don't have any kind of data or numbers on how often that happens, though.
And Betty, for your question about farmers, about multiple generations of farmers, it's probably safer to say yes. A lot of them have grown up on the farm and their grandfather also grew up in a lot of areas. Mm-hmm. And that's from majority areas where we're working with the farmers that we work with. So that, I hope that answers your question about that. And then the question here from Jane, the estimate number of blue cranes in the Western Cape.
So that's something we're trying to figure out. So our latest estimate from a number of years ago now was, I think, 25,000 for the whole country. But this estimate was definitely a minimum estimate. So what we tried to do with the aerial survey data to try and kind of extrapolate our data to get a sense of blue crane numbers in the whole of the Western Cape. I'm not 100% happy with my analysis at the moment, so that's something we're still working on, just trying to figure out how many cranes there are. It's quite a difficult thing to work out, particularly because you can't count all of them. So that's something that I'm still working on.
And a bit about the defensive behaviors of the species. I must say, from my side, when they got chicks, they do like a broken wing thing when they walk around looking like they've got a broken wing, that your attention will go onto the adult rather than the chicks. So they do that as a defensive way in that way. But from a, I don't want to add anything to that, Christy, about defensive behaviors.
Yeah, definitely. You often see that kind of broken wing distraction type thing. I have heard of quite aggressive fights between blue cranes. I've never seen it happen though, but I have heard of cases of a crane killing another crane.
And yeah, just our last question here, we've only got time for one more question here, and that is, what can we do to help the project?
So ICF and EWT are both donor and member supported organizations. So a great way to help is to become a member, and you can have a look at our website, savingcranes.org, for some details on the website. You can also make a donation. You can specify to the project if you would like. I think just in general, if you can't become a member or donate, one way that I know ICF and EWT have opportunities for volunteering, and there are many ways that you can help cranes. And one of the ways, and particularly if you are based in South Africa or even visiting South Africa, is to participate in some of these citizen science projects, because it's really valuable data and it's really important to have this long-term data set. So get involved with the CAR project in your region, or get involved with SABAP and submit data. SABAP can submitted through an app called Bird Masses, so it's actually really, really easy to do and lots of fun. So yeah, that would be, I think, one of the main ways that you can help.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Great, thanks everybody. So just another big thank you to Tom and Kathy Leiden for supporting today's webinar. And again, there are Kate Fitzwilliam's details if you are keen to support one of our upcoming webinars. So next week, we've got a webinar from Anne Lacey, and she's going to be talking to us about the sandhill cranes, which is a species in America, which is also quite well adapted to agriculture. So tune in next week for our next From the Field webinar. And thanks so much. Thanks for joining.
Thanks, everyone.
Cheers.